Boy, do I have a good one for y'all today. This laptop right here is the Asus Flow X16. This thing is truly one of a kind and checks off quite a few firsts in the gaming laptop industry. First of all, it's the first 2-in-1 gaming laptop of its size. It's one of the very few touchscreen gaming laptops out there, and it's the only gaming laptop other than the Asus Zephyrus Duo to have a mini LED screen. I'm not gonna lie, this is the laptop I've been most excited to get my hands on since it was announced. Asus really went with almost zero compromises on this thing. And you can tell that they were trying to answer some of the requests that people have had for a while on their gaming laptops. 16:10 aspect ratio, a beautiful fully HDR compatible display, new and improved cooling with 3 fans, and the ability to further boost performance with the XG mobile port, being able to actually upgrade your RAM and SSD on a thin laptop, and much more. There's just a lot of really cool features with this thing, so let's get into it. So in the US, there's only 2 models to choose from, this one being the more powerful of the two. The one I have here features the AMD Ryzen 9 6900HS and NVIDIA RTX 3070 Ti. It can only be purchased directly from Asus, whereas the other US model is from Best Buy. That one ditches the mini LED screen for an IPS panel and an RTX 3060, and it's around $800 less. The Ryzen 9 6900HS can run up to 95 watts, and the NVIDIA RTX 3070 Ti can run up to 125 watts. Of course, not at the same time though. It all depends on the task you're doing. The 6900HS features RDNA 2 graphics for when you're in iGPU mode, helping you still get decent graphics performance without that RTX active. And the RTX 3070 Ti features NVIDIA's Max Q4 feature set, which I don't see people talk about very often, but it basically has some cool little features that are unique to these mobile Ti GPUs. But anyways, let's talk about the design first, because this thing is crazy. So first, let's state the obvious that the overall design of the X16 is like that of a larger X13. The X13 being a smaller 13-inch device that obviously has much weaker components, but with the same sort of idea. This thing is sleek and beautiful without really screaming gamer. It's got a magnesium alloy body, so it feels nice and sturdy. Magnesium alloy isn't quite as metal feeling as aluminum laptops, but it's not nearly as cheap feeling as plastic either. It gives you a lot of sturdiness without the added weight, which I like. It's also very fingerprint resistant. Fingerprint magnets like the Razer Blade 15 or the Zephyrus M16 are a pet peeve of mine, so I'm glad Asus chose a good resistant coating here. So unlike the Ergo Lift hinge on the Zephyrus series, you have a full 360-degree rotating hinge on the X16. I've seen some concerns from other reviewers that the hinges might be a little weak, but they're really not bad at all. I'd say about your average hinge strength. Allows you to easily flip it over to tent mode or tablet mode without too much force, but also without it just like flopping over. It also has very small feet on the back, so it looks very flat on a table in comparison to other gaming laptops. But it has to do this though because of that 360-degree hinge, so the feet of the laptop don't just like annihilate the screen when you flip it back. Sure, this may leave some concerns for cooling without much room underneath the laptop for airflow, but Asus had some tricks up their sleeves with this one, so we'll talk about that soon. You have these little line ridges around the body of the laptop that actually provide a bit of texture, which I think is really cool, and they even continue the pattern on the trackpad, but obviously there's not texture there because it's a glass trackpad, but it kind of throws you off because it just blends right into the rest of the body. I think it looks really cool though. Your keyboard and trackpad are obviously centered here, which I love that in a laptop. Numpads typically have the keyboard and trackpad getting shifted left and more squished, which I hate, so very thankful that Asus kept it centered and spacious here. Also, this keyboard feels awesome to type on. The Zephyrus G15 has always been my favorite laptop keyboard to type on, and this one is very close to it in quality. The only difference is they made the keys just slightly more stiff on this model, and I'm pretty sure that was purposeful because even though keys that are like a little more loose typically feel better, you don't want to feel the looseness of your keys when you're in tablet mode. So that little extra tightness sort of helps keep all the keys the same height and position for when you're in tablet mode, or if it's laying on top of the keyboard. Seems to help with that so it's not all clacking and making noise and shifting whenever you're holding it. And it's single zone RGB, and you can control your effects through Armory Crate. The only thing ROG laptops are lacking is a function lock and a print screen button, but I've gotten used to that by now. You also have 4 quick action buttons up here at the top, which you can change to a variety of different functions using Armory Crate. The G15 also had my favorite trackpad of any laptop, and this one's also right up there with that, but just slightly different. It requires a little less effort to click, and it has a little louder and higher pitch click than the G15, but overall, it's a big glass trackpad and feels extremely smooth and easy to use. I also threw in the Blade 15 for extra comparison here. That one's keyboard is a little more clacky and loose like a MacBook, but feels really good as well. And the Blade's trackpad feels almost like a hybrid between these two, with a sort of soft click and a medium amount of effort to click. So here's all those mentioned keyboards and trackpads in comparison to each other. Some other cool subtleties with the design is that the entire rear portion of the laptop is an exhaust vent, and you've only got one side exhaust vent on the right side, which frees up more space for ports and stuff on the left side. The power button is also on the side, which makes sense for a two-in-one to have. Some people were concerned about accidentally pressing it all the time, but it's really harder to do than you think. The position hasn't really bothered me. I feel like it's in a decent spot since you definitely don't want to put it on the keyboard deck. The bottom of the keyboard deck has a little cutout, which makes it easy to lift the hinge from being closed. And then, of course, you've got your full range of motion here. So there's a variety of different ways you can position this laptop. Maybe you want temp mode for gaming on a controller or watching a movie, or maybe you want tablet mode for doing a drawing or maybe scrolling through websites vertically. There's just lots of possibilities here. The laptop itself is about 4.5 pounds, so about the same weight as other thinner and lighter gaming laptops like the Zephyrus G15. The 3060 model with the IPS display is actually a tiny bit lighter at 4.4 pounds because it doesn't have the mini LED panel, so I thought that was interesting. The 3060 model also comes in a darker black finish compared to the sort of gunmetal gray that this one has. You also get the standard 240 watt charging brick, which is pretty compact for how much power you're getting here, especially compared to some of the 300 watt adapters out there, like the ones from Lenovo, which are just huge. So compared to the Zephyrus G15, for example, the body is very similar in size and thickness, almost identical other than it laying flatter on a table with the smaller feet. It also sort of appears thinner than the G15 too because of the way that they shaped the ends of the body right here to look a little thinner. Even though it angles inward to a thicker chassis, it's like it's all in the perception of it. And that was an interesting design choice, but I like it. Here it is next to the Razer Blade 15 and the Dell Precision 15 or XPS 15. They're both the same chassis, I think. And it doesn't really look huge in comparison. It's basically the same size as the Blade 15 and only slightly larger than the XPS 15. So overall, it's just a really nice and sleek design that doesn't look too gamery, and it's super easy to carry around or throw in a bag and go. Now, it would be wrong of me not to mention, though, that from talking to other X16 owners, I've seen a higher than normal amount of defects in people's units. I bought mine myself as a retail unit from Asus, and it arrived perfect with no issues. But I've seen a few issues people have had with their like screens or fans or keyboard not operating the way it should. So I just thought I'd mention that in case you get it. Just make sure to check all those things before your exchange period is up. I mean, this is a new first generation device, and I wouldn't be surprised if it was rushed out the door. I'm sure quality control and software and all that will improve in the future. But like I said, I'm just pointing that out, not to scare anyone away, but just something to be aware of as the device just released. And I think Asus must be aware of this too, because they've pulled it from their online store a couple times now and put it back up. So all right, so let's cut to the display, since that's really the star of the show here. Here we have the first ever mini LED display in a gaming laptop. The only other laptop right now to have a mini LED display is the Zephyrus Duo, which uses the same display actually, and the MacBook Pro, which is even better than this one because it has more dimming zones, but this thing is still awesome. It's a 165 hertz QHD 1600p touchscreen display. It has 512 dimming zones, meaning it can actively dim local zones of pixels in order to provide amazing contrast and black levels that are pretty close to OLED. Sure, you won't get the perfect blacks like on OLED panels, but what you do get is an insane amount of brightness. 1100 nits peak brightness to be exact. And my God, I'd be lying if I didn't say that this was the most bright and beautiful display I have ever seen. They even give you some customization with being able to turn the dimming zones on or off, which is really nice to have. Color accuracy is amazing with 100% DCI-P3 and over 90% Adobe RGB. Although colors can look slightly different with multi-zone dimming on, so it's best to do color-sensitive work with that setting off, so in single zone. And you can change that setting right here in Armory Crate, although I wish they just had a keyboard shortcut for it because I find myself needing to switch it pretty often. But when you're gaming or watching movies, that multi-zone dimming just looks so freaking good. And then they went and made the panel glossy, which is just the cherry on top. And I know some people will be concerned with reflections on a glossy panel, but they haven't really been an issue at all for me. And with the brightness of this thing, you don't even notice. But what is noticeable is that extra clarity of having a glossy panel over a matte one, which is sort of hard to see on video, but just in this clip right here of it next to the Blade and the Zephyrus G15, you can just tell the image looks better on the glossy panel, like without a doubt. Coming back to brightness, this is the first gaming laptop out there that I know of to be Display HDR 1000 certified, which is like real HDR. A lot of other laptops that have HDR compatibility, they're compatible, but they don't have the color gamut, they don't have the brightness, or they don't have the right contrast. They're just missing certain components of a true HDR experience, but this one has it all. And it looks amazing. Just keep in mind, the 1100 nits is only the peak brightness when viewing content in HDR. So without HDR activated, your peak brightness is around like 900 nits, I think, or 500 nits when you're only using single zone lighting, which, I mean, even 500 nits is still pretty bright. Also, just a heads up, if you get one, there's a weird bug where if you're using the laptop in DGPU or ultimate mode in Armory Crate, the HDR doesn't work correctly and it kind of makes everything look washed out. So this will probably get fixed in a future update from either Windows or Asus or whoever's responsible. But I just wanted to point that out. If you plan on using HDR, make sure it's in hybrid mode, which is anything other than the ultimate mode in Armory Crate. So not only is this screen super bright and colorful, but you can touch it. You've got a Gorilla Glass touchscreen here with pin support, and that's just insane to have on a laptop like this. I also like how having this kind of makes the bezels disappear behind the glass, which to me just looks way cleaner than having the bezels poke out. Speaking of bezels, you also lose that chin that's found on most other 16:9 displays because this one has a 16:10 aspect ratio, which makes a lot of sense on a device like this with a touchscreen because having that extra vertical space is just nice for scrolling or creating. Normally, I'm not a fan of the black bars that you get when you're gaming at 16:9 on a 16:10 laptop, but with all the dimming zones, the black bars are not illuminated like they are on other laptops, so it just looks so much better. Plus, my unit had absolutely zero backlight bleed, which seems to be the same for everyone else I've talked to with this screen. Oh, also, the touchscreen is really responsive for pin support, and that works really nicely as well. You can see here, I'm messing around with it in Photoshop, and I was actually really surprised at how responsive and just instant that it picked up on the... I'm just using the Microsoft Surface pen here with Photoshop and just Paint, and it did really good. It was kind of cool using the little gestures, and so that was kind of cool. And the pressure sensor seems to be really good too. It noticed when I would press harder that the brush would increase in size a little bit, so that was cool. Not something I'll probably use very often, but for those of you who do like to use a pen, it does a good job. So another thing we also get is a webcam with Windows Hello support, which is nice to have for a quick sign-in experience. The quality is about on par with the G15 and most other gaming laptops, which means it's not great, but it gets the job done. Now, the only drawback to the mini LED display I want to point out really quick is that if you're on low brightness and you're looking at something with a gray background or something with a darker background, you're going to get sort of this spotty effect. It's not a defect or anything. It's just the dimming zones being active on gray areas and low brightness, so you're able to see them easier. You might also notice things like your mouse pointer being darker when it's hovering over a dark background. That's just because that zone is being dimmed, so it dims your mouse pointer a little bit with it. And you might also notice some of these zones sort of illuminating around the mouse. But I mean, these are all very tiny nitpicks and they really don't take much away from the experience. Just something to be aware of because that's how the technology works. When you want to run on a lower brightness setting or you just need uniform brightness throughout the whole panel, just switch it over to single zone and boom, you're good to go. And it still looks amazing. So overall on the screen, I'd say for a lot of people, this might just be the preferred type of display to have over OLED, like the one in the GE67HX, because this mini LED gets more than twice as bright as OLED, and the colors and blacks are pretty darn close to OLED. It's glossy like the OLED panels are, it's a touchscreen, it's 16:10, and you don't have to worry about burn-in or anything like that. I've had my eye on those new OLED panels in the Blade 15 and that MSI, but honestly, I feel like this display is currently the better choice for most people for those reasons. And before we continue, I just want to say that a lot of my views come from people who are not subscribed to the channel, so it would really help the channel grow so that I can keep making content like this. If you just hit the subscribe button, maybe hit that bell, leave a like, all those things help the channel, and that's the stuff that motivates me to make better videos, to make more videos, and get them out more quickly. Anyways, thanks so much. Let's get back to it. All right, so let's talk ports. So the Flow X16 gives us a decent variety of ports, one of which could be a game changer for some people. So I'm gonna start on the left side since that's where the action is. So thanks to them not having a fan exhaust on this side, you actually get a power plug located near the top, which is really nice actually compared to the G15 that's like right in the middle on that one. You also get an HDMI 2.0B port, which there was a little bit of controversy around. Obviously everyone would prefer for this to be HDMI 2.1, and at first it was. The review units they sent out were all able to push out 4K at 120Hz from this port, but for some reason Asus took it out of the final retail units and tried their best to cover up any mention of HDMI 2.1 on their website, which they still missed a few. So that's unfortunate that you can't get 4K 120 out of this, but you do have two high bandwidth USB-C ports with DisplayPort output, one of which is connected to the Radeon graphics while the other one is connected directly to the NVIDIA graphics. This is why even if you're in DGPU mode, you might still see the Radeon graphics active because it's there in case you plug anything into that port. And we're also getting USB 4 on these ports in the future update later this year, so that'll be awesome to have Thunderbolt compatible ports on this machine soon. Now we'll come back to this XG mobile port in a second, but the other port here is the audio combo jack and your battery and disk activity lights, which are much nicer to have right here than right under the screen reflecting onto it like they do on the G15 and M16. All right, on the right side you have two USB 3.2 Gen 2 Type A ports and a micro SD card slot. Some people hate on the micro SD versus the full size SD, but I actually prefer it because the card doesn't stick out like many of the full size ones do. So you can use this as like a cheap and easy storage expansion for stuff where you don't need a super fast read and write speed. Like for example, I recorded this whole video using a high speed micro SD card and an adapter that I had plugged into my camera, and I just popped it out for transferring all the files right here in minutes, really. And then lastly, of course, you have your power button right here with a light to show you that it's on. All right, let's go back to the left side real quick. So the USB-C port on the left side is actually hidden behind this little rubber ROG plate, which reveals to you the Asus XG mobile port. This port allows you to plug in an external GPU from Asus. And these things are pretty awesome because they feature direct PCI GPU connection, which gives much better bandwidth than like a Thunderbolt GPU enclosure. And they're like a fraction of the size. So having one of these also adds more ports for connectivity as well, and can easily just fit in your bag on the go, and it charges your laptop, so you can have it in replace of your power brick. So they put this here because it's on all of the Flow series laptops, and even though this GPU is pretty much like almost as powerful right now as their highest tier XG mobile GPU, they made this with future proofing in mind, because in 3 or 4 years, you know, the RTX 5080 XG mobile will get made, and you can just buy that and not have to worry so much about being behind everyone else and replacing your entire setup. All right, so speakers. They are wonderful on this laptop. It has the same speaker setup as the G15, but it's just missing two extra tweeters. But honestly, the difference isn't that noticeable. Treble frequencies still come through great even without the tweeters. The G15 definitely still has the best speakers of any gaming laptop I've used, but this one's not far behind. And if you do a few tweaks in the Dolby settings, you can get this thing sounding really good. Not like MacBook good, but better than like 99% of other gaming laptops good. Because unlike other brands, these speakers have actual punch to them, which hopefully you can hear in this comparison. All right. Now let's talk internals. So the internals on this thing are actually pretty exciting. There's a few new things here that Asus is really experimenting with, and it's working. So of course you've got right here your PCIe Gen 4 SSD, which for some reason wasn't as thickly padded as the one in the G15, yet it runs at much higher speeds. Those speeds are cut down a bit on battery, but that's a good thing because Gen 4 SSDs do consume more power. And for most people, you know, even Gen 3 speeds are more than enough for just about everything. You also have an extra storage SSD slot right here, which goes either over or under this cable right here. They don't really give instructions on that, so I put mine under it and it seems to fit just fine. And now, for the first time ever, a thin gaming laptop besides the Blade 15 actually has two replaceable RAM slots. I don't know how they did it, but they did it. And boy, am I glad they did. Mine came with two 16 gigabyte single rank sticks of DDR5 RAM for a total of 32 gigabytes. Each stick of DDR5 RAM runs in dual channels, so this is 32 gigabytes running in quad channel. Obviously, this is preferable over, say, having 8 gigabytes soldered on, like on the G15, since for that one, only the first 16 gigabytes will run in quad channel and the rest will run in dual channel if you decide to upgrade. Not that it's a huge performance hit or anything, it's just nice to have 32 gigabytes and not have to worry about it. In fact, my G15 performed a little better even with 24 gigabytes than it did with the 16 that it came with stock. But I have a whole other video on that on the 2021 model and one for the 2022 model on the way. You also get a MediaTek Wi-Fi 6E card, which can be swapped out, and it's located right under the primary SSD. It runs fine for me, but I've heard that it's not the most compatible card for some people's routers. All right, next, looking at the cooling here, it's actually pretty unique. Asus definitely took their time in building a very well thought out cooling system here. First of all, you've got thermal grizzly liquid metal on the CPU, of course. Then you've got 5 heat pipes going across, which are decently sized. And then you've got this unique fan setup here. The fans have variable thickness on the blades for more efficiency, and you have 3 of them. That's the crazy part. They put in a dedicated third fan just for sending more airflow through the center and to keep everything cooled better and reducing the overall fan noise and output from the other two. And then, like I mentioned in the design section, you've got the entire rear of the laptop dedicated to cooling. This is just a giant heat sink, and I think as a whole, they've done a really good job, which I'll show later on. There's also some other just subtle differences between this and like that of the Zephyrus models. You get a dust filter for the intake vent, which is great because that means less dust clogging up the fans over time, and they don't seem like the type that would reduce airflow either. It's also got just a few little things like how the Zephyrus had these copper sections here on the bottom plate and the X16 doesn't, and the battery covers are a little different. I don't know what all thought went into that, but I'm sure it had some sort of purpose to it. Getting inside was also a little easier than on the G15 because you don't have to deal with those hidden screws that are underneath the rubber caps. So overall, they have a surprisingly high amount of upgradeability here, despite how thin and light this laptop is. Okay, so for software, you've got Armory Crate here, which, like I said in my last video, I think is personally one of the best laptop control softwares out there. Of all the ones I use, that you just get customization options in Armory Crate that the others don't have. You know, you've got fan speeds at different temperature levels. You can change your CPU wattage and boost wattage, GPU overclocking and thermal limits. You can disable the GPU completely if you want, and much more. So let's walk through it really quick. So firstly, we've got the performance profiles. Choosing Windows just means it's going to use whatever default Windows plan is available. Silent mode prioritizes fan noise to make sure that the fans are either entirely off or just barely on, which it does great at. Performance mode gives you pretty good performance, just not the full amount, but runs fairly quiet still. And then turbo prioritizes maximum CPU and GPU wattage, with the fans being turned up to properly cool that higher power output. Lastly, manual mode is where you go to get your completely customized power plan. On the CPU tab, you can change your SPL, which is your sustained CPU wattage, your SPPT, which is your boost wattage, and your FPPT, which is your short boost wattage. These wattages are only possible in a CPU only workload, so don't expect to see 95 watts coming out of your CPU during a game. You've also got fan curves right here. You can adjust them to your liking. My suggestion is to just run a game or a benchmark and just experiment with different fan speeds to see what gives you the best balance of noise and performance. On the GPU tab, you have overclocking settings, which lets you push your GPU just a little harder. You've got your thermal target, which determines the max temperature you'd like the GPU to reach, and it'll tune down the performance accordingly just to make sure it doesn't hit that temperature. For max performance, just leave it at 87 degrees since it doesn't really ever get that high anyway. You've also got a dynamic boost slider, which allows more or less boost wattage to the GPU. Turning this down to 5 will let the GPU run at 105 watts total and allow more headroom for the CPU, or keep it at 25 for maximum GPU power of 125 watts. Whether it actually hits that full wattage depends on the task or the game that you're playing, of course. GPU power savings lowers the clock speed and wattage of the GPU accordingly to reduce temps and noise, so that's good to use if you don't plan on using the GPU much. And then, unlike some of the 2021 Asus laptops, you can access manual mode on battery. It has a few less settings, but it's super cool that they added this. Now, in the system configuration panel here, you've got your MUX switch, which isn't found on 2021 Asus laptops. This allows you to completely disable the integrated graphics so that you can get full performance from your RTX 3070 Ti. This usually gives about a 5-10% performance increase in games, depending on the title and resolution. Some games like CSGO, you can literally see double the performance from this, so just keep that in mind. Having the GPU mode on Ultimate is the MUX switch. They recently renamed all this stuff to make it more user-friendly. Standard GPU mode is hybrid mode, which means everything going to the display is passed through Radeon first, which has the added benefit of giving you FreeSync. Since HDR works best on this setting, this is actually how I plan to use my X16 most of the time. And Eco mode is for when you want to completely disable the NVIDIA graphics. This is great for extending battery life and decreasing fan noise and temperatures for when you're just using the laptop for basic tasks. And then optimized will either turn the NVIDIA graphics on or off depending on what you're doing. This is good for if you just don't like to think about these kinds of things. Other settings here allow you to disable the Windows key, disable the touchpad, disable the boot up sound. Panel overdrive gives you faster screen response time. Panel power saver automatically switches your panel's refresh rate to 60 hertz when you're on battery, which gives you a little extra battery life. And then backlight control here is for turning on or off the dimming zones to take full advantage of your mini LED display, which, like I said, I wish I had a shortcut or something in like the taskbar, because it's one of the settings that I feel like a lot of people are going to use quite often. And if Asus doesn't make one for it, I'm sure someone will. Other settings include freeing up your memory, customizable hotkeys, lighting effects, audio microphone modes, display color settings, scenario profiles, which allows you to link certain system actions to triggers that you determine, and then other stuff like news and updates. The BIOS is pretty basic, nothing crazy here like on the MSI laptops, just your average options that you would see on most gaming laptops. All right, so battery life. Battery life can vary a good bit depending on the tweaks that you make and the things that you're doing. Out of the box, I got 7 hours of battery life on my X16 with a YouTube playback test. That was with the keyboard lights on, the display at just under 50%, the speakers active, and the refresh rate was still at 165 hertz. So it seems to be very possible to get up to 8 or so hours or more with a few tweaks, like setting your minimum processor state to 0%, running in eco mode, turning on panel power saver. There's more advanced tweaks out there that people have written guides for on Reddit, but that's just for those who want to squeeze out every extra 10 minutes or so that they can. Overall though, it's an AMD CPU, so it's naturally just going to have much better battery life than anything from Intel, as well as having better performance on battery as well. So if battery life is your top concern, then it might be worth looking at the IPS display model, because that one actually gets about an extra hour or so over the mini LED model. And that's just because of the backlight technology. All right, so performance on battery. It's such a nice advantage with these new laptops from Asus, because if you check my G15 video where I compared it to last year's top of the line Legion 7 with the 5900HX and the 3080, it just smoked it on battery. For example, like Shadow of the Tomb Raider here, the Legion on battery was getting like 19 FPS, while the G15 and the X16 both get over 50 FPS without even eating any more battery life either. Programs like Adobe Premiere Pro still perform great on battery. Cinebench scores are really high on battery. Time Spy, comparatively to other laptops, these are like the battery performance kings. I'm not sure if that's an Asus thing or just a TI GPU thing or a Ryzen 6900 thing, but whatever it is, it's working. You also have the Radeon 680M RDNA2 integrated graphics. So if you've disabled your NVIDIA GPU completely using Eco mode, you can still use these powerful integrated graphics to run programs and games at lower settings. Like here I am, Forza Horizon 5, no GPU active, just the integrated graphics, and it looks this good. Okay, so CPU performance. So I was surprised to learn that the CPU on this thing actually runs at higher wattages than the G15 can. I was expecting them to be the same, or maybe even this one was going to be lower, but nah, this thing can run up to 95 watts. That's 15 more watts going to the CPU than on the G15. And it does it at like half the fan noise, so that's crazy. Manual mode only shows 90 watts for some reason, but running Cinebench and Turbo actually pulled 93 to 94 watts consistently throughout and got us a score of just over 15,000. It also scored higher this way than running in manual mode, even with maxed out fans and sliders. Just something to note for those of you trying to benchmark this thing. Like the G15, the X16 performs a little differently in hybrid mode than in DGPU mode. In hybrid, or just whenever the GPU mode is anything but ultimate, Turbo actually pulls 87 watts instead of 95, but it really only lowered the multi-core score in Cinebench by like 300 points. So it's not bad. Manual mode hits about 89 watts in DGPU and about 87 in hybrid. Performance mode pulls about 80 watts in DGPU or 70 in hybrid. And then silent mode pulls like 65 watts in DGPU or 45 watts in hybrid, which is like a oddly large gap, but despite that big wattage gap there, it still scores about the same. So that's pretty much the case for all of these actually. Even though there's that wattage difference, they all score about the same. And honestly, I'm super impressed with how this thing does in silent mode. It easily breaks over 13,000 Cinebench score in silent, and you can barely even hear the fans going. So to put that in perspective, that's basically the same score as the 2021's Zephyrus G15 in turbo with the fans going full blast almost. And also the Ryzen 6900HS can be undervolted thanks to AATU. This got me a score of around 15,300 multi-core with no change in temperatures, which puts this pretty darn close to some of those 12th gen Intel laptops. Sure, it won't be up there with the thicker ones, but getting over 15K in Cinebench is impressive for Ryzen. I'm working on a dedicated undervolting video, so stay tuned for that. Also, just keep in mind that these stress tests will push the CPU to its limits, so seeing the temperatures in the upper 80s, lower 90s here, that's no surprise. But what is a surprise is how much quieter it was doing this than the 2022 G15. So props to them on the fan tuning here, because that's amazing. Because even though my manual mode was running at higher fan speeds, turbo actually performed better while running quieter. And then here's some other CPU benchmarks like Geekbench, which scores pretty well compared to the G15, surpassing it just a little bit, and of course surpassing the top spec Legion 7 from last year. And here are the RAM speeds, which again, they're pretty on par with other DDR5 RAM speeds. Now, Arpeggio scores were pretty high here. In Premiere Pro, that's a very RAM-hungry program, so it's no surprise that it scored higher than the 2022 G15 did, but still falls behind 12th Gen Intel, like in my Blade 15 right here. On battery, however, it's a different story. It now surpasses that 12th Gen Intel, so that's good to note for creators on the go. Arpeggio Photoshop scores were good too, pretty on par with what I got in the Blade 15, actually. And then lastly, I've added a music benchmark for the audio people out there like myself. This might not be the most comprehensive one, but I found it because Ableton is a pretty CPU heavy DAW and it's my favorite, so I thought this might paint a good picture once I get more results from other laptops. The way it works is I just run a tutorial session from Ableton at a 512 sample rate and noted where the CPU was peaking, which was usually in the first verse of this song. So for the Flow X16, it peaked at around 29% CPU load. Comparing that to the Blade 15, that one peaked at around 21% CPU load. So you're getting a little better performance on the Blade, but the Flow is still killing it here for audio applications. Speaking of audio, here are the latency mon results. The NVIDIA drivers always cause issues with DPC latencies, so I found that using the laptop in eco mode greatly improved this. Okay, so let's talk thermals really quick. People had a lot of concerns with how the Flow would perform thermally when it was announced, and even some of the engineering and review samples that were sent out ran a little warm, but I was pleasantly surprised to find out this thing runs much cooler than I thought it would. So in Apex Legends here at max settings, we're getting about 76 degrees on the GPU, topping out at about 79, and around 82 degrees on the CPU, which is running over 4,000 megahertz in the clock speed. So if you disable CPU boost, that CPU really only runs at like 73 degrees. Compare that to the top of the line Legion 7 from last year, which had some of the best cooling out there with a vapor chamber and everything. That thing was hitting, you know, upper 90s on the CPU. So I think that third fan is really helping here. Really just the whole combination of thermal tweaks that Asus has made seems to be helping, despite having those shorter feet that should technically be straining the thermals a little bit. So that's why I ran Apex again, but this time in temp mode, and saw the temperatures drop a decent amount. So if thermals are, you know, a concern of yours, temp mode is definitely a good option, or just a decent laptop stand to prop it up a bit. And I saw a couple reviews saying that their unit was thermal throttling all the time, and I don't have any idea how that could have happened, unless theirs just had like defective liquid metal application or something. And they just didn't realize, because I mean, this thing runs way cooler than like a lot of the 2021 laptops did, especially for how quiet the fans are. And then ambient temperatures are not the lowest I've seen, but they're very acceptable, and it's nothing I would ever be concerned about. The CPU just stays around 50 to 55 with just some basic things open like Discord and a few browser tabs. And then on battery, this drops to about the 40s. Okay, so fan noise. So honestly, fan noise is where the X16 really won my heart. So for comparison, the Blade 15 is one of the quietest gaming laptops out there right now. In a lot of tests, the the X16 ran quieter. So first off, silent mode is excellent. It can pretty much always obtain a dead silent machine with either fans turned completely off or just barely running to where you can't really hear them. This laptop and pretty much all the other ROG laptops have the best silent mode that I've ever tested because they actually perform pretty decently in silent mode too. I've tested stuff, you know, from MSI, Lenovo Legion 5 Pro, Legion 7, Legion 7i. All of them struggle in their quietest power profiles, so I'm glad Asus really tuned this right. And then comparatively to the new G15, this is a much quieter laptop under load as well. In performance mode, this thing runs at around 43 decibels while giving way better performance than the G15's performance mode. And in turbo mode, it barely hits like 49 to 50 decibels, which is really nothing compared to the 2022 G15, which can hit like 55, 56 decibels. So considering how decibels scale, that's roughly like 5 times as intense of a sound. The Blade 15 also hits around 49, 50 decibels under max power and comes in at only 41 decibels in its balance mode, which is insanely quiet. So it does have the X16 beat there, but not by much. Overall though, this is one of the first gaming laptops where I could feel comfortable gaming in performance mode around people instead of silent, so props to Asus there. So the way you position this laptop obviously affects the performance. You know, there's a few different ways you can use this laptop with the rotating hinge here. I'll use the time spy score of the stock clamshell mode as a baseline here. Standard clamshell pushes out the most wattage typically for some reason. For some reason, temp mode actually doesn't quite hit the same peak CPU wattage that clamshell does, but it does offer better temperature. So what seems to be best for thermals is temp mode. Sure, you lose access to the keyboard, of course, but this is great for people who have an external keyboard and a mouse, or they just want to play on controller. It reduces the temperatures, of course. Fan noise goes down a bit, although the exhaust is now pointed upwards and at you, sort of, so even though the fans aren't running as fast, they still sound about the same, but the drops in temps is nice. Then you've got tablet mode, which Armor You Create recognizes and gives it its own performance profile. That one is basically silent, like silent mode, and performance is the lowest of all modes here, unsurprisingly, but still very acceptable for most tasks. And you can also use the keyboard face down behind the screen, although I'm not sure what that would be best for, except for like a very specific setup maybe. And sure, this thing is not the most comfortable tablet to hold out there. I mean, it's a 16-inch, 4.5-pound tablet. That's never going to be as intuitive as a 13-inch or smaller, but the option is nice, and it works really well when you want it to. You can have this as a vertical touchscreen hooked up to an external monitor if you want to, even. The hinge just gives you a lot of options. You know, I wouldn't buy this laptop specifically for those options, but they are good to have. I plan to use it mostly in the stock clamshell mode, but I just like having a touchscreen with pin support when I need it occasionally, and or if I just want to scroll through websites vertically or just use it like a big iPad or something. All right, so gaming performance. So like I said in the 2022 G15 video, the 3070 Ti's seem to have a big discrepancy in their GPU scores and time spy for some reason. The 3070 Ti here runs at 125 watts maximum, but usually stays around 115, 120. It scores well in time spy, and you can easily overclock it with barely any increase in temperatures, and it'll reach scores that match some of the higher powered 150 watt 3070 Ti's out there. But we're gonna see how it performs in games, since it's a gaming laptop after all, first and foremost. So these benchmarks were all run in DGPU Ultimate mode on Turbo. This would be how I recommend playing for anyone looking to get the max wattage from their machine. All right, let's start with Shadow of the Tomb Raider, since that's one of my favorite ones to benchmark. As you can see, the flow is getting 95 FPS here at QHD, you know, just 1 FPS ahead of the G15, and pretty on par with, you know, like the Legion 7i from last year, only a couple FPS away from these Razer Blades, and honestly not too far behind some of these 3080s either that have 165 watts. So pretty good overall. A couple of these data points I got with permission from Jarrod's tech, like the MSI GP66, which for some reason just knocks it out of the park. But either way, I mean, 95 FPS, that's doing way better than like last year's G15. And then drop it down to 1080p, it's actually doing a little better than the G15 here. about 5 FPS more, and it's ahead of, you know, some 3080s. It's ahead of the G14. It's, of course, ahead of the tough A15 3060. I mean, it's doing really good in comparison to a lot of these laptops, and even the ones that it's behind, it's just barely behind them. Okay, Forza Horizon 5 running the extreme preset at QHD. The Flow X16 is doing good at 73 FPS. Sure, it's not going to get close to those MSIs up there at the top. Those things are just a whole different kind of beast, but you know, they're also a lot thicker than this too. But 73 FPS is looking really good. It's ahead of some of these 3080s from last year. So I'm happy with that. Drop it down to 1080p. It's near the top of my results other than the MSIs right here. 84 FPS, which is, again, really good. And, you know, only one FPS higher than the G15. So that's just something I've noticed across the board. You know, very similar setup to G15. So it's no surprise that it's performing very similarly. Okay, so Control here is a very GPU heavy game. On the high preset with ray tracing on high, QHD, we're getting 45 FPS, which, you know, this game runs pretty close to the same on all laptops when you have it on these settings. So 45, you know, even though it's at the top, it's about the same as most others. Then when you turn DLSS on, things change a little bit. It's still ahead of pretty much every other gaming laptop I have except for the Blade 15. So that's good to see. And then Call of Duty Warzone, this is max settings, ray tracing on in the Warzone training area. On QHD, it's getting about 113 FPS in that area, which, again, pretty on par with the G15. When you turn DLSS on, it gets a little boost in FPS, but the G15 actually came out a few FPS ahead here, but it's still so close, it could almost be margin of error. And, you know, even though it's at the bottom of this chart, the only ones at the top are these super high wattage 3080s, so, which for some reason just seem to do better in this game. Now, Cyberpunk, we're getting 49 FPS, matching the G15. Very happy with that score, not too far behind some of these higher wattage 3080s again. Now, when you turn ray tracing on, getting 48 FPS, still great. Closes the gap just a little bit between that and the 3080s. And then on the high preset, it's getting about 61 FPS. So just a couple FPS more than the G15 here. Maybe that extra 5 watts is doing something here, not sure, but these are great results. Red Dead Redemption 2, also GPU bound. This is with the favorite quality slider max. At QHD, we're getting 62 FPS. Again, on par with the G15, on par with the Blade 15. Turn it down to 1080p, and we are actually a little bit behind the G15 for some reason on this one. I don't really know why. I ran it like 5 times just to make sure, but yeah, so for some reason, G15 does a little better in 1080p on Red Dead Redemption 2. And CSGO is a more CPU-bound game. At QHD, we're getting 363 FPS, which is a great result. You know, looking at last year's G15 in hybrid mode, it's way better than that. And then if you drop that one down to 1080p, we're getting 443, which puts it just barely above the G15. But it's right in line with, you know, some much more thick and powerful laptops. So that's great to see. Horizon Zero Dawn. So this is on the ultimate quality preset, the benchmark. Running at QHD, we got 87 FPS here. So only one FPS ahead of the G15. As you can see, it's on par with some thicker and heavier machines. And, you know, the ones that it's behind, it's really not too far behind those. Really, it's just like the GE76 and GE66 that are like dominating here. But drop it down to 1080p and getting 103 FPS, which, again, really good. 2 FPS ahead of the G15. You know, quite a bit more ahead of last year's G15. So that's good to see. So performance-wise in games, this thing is great. I mean, obviously on some of my charts, it appears lower because all I have is data from a bunch of high-wattage 3080s, but all in all, it gets pretty close to those in a lot of games and even beats out a few of them in some games. And of course, it also beats out some of the 3070s that had higher wattage from last year. So, you know, it's definitely not going to beat something like the beefier MSI laptops out there, but they're beefier for a reason. And of course, you lose a lot of the cool extra features when you go that route in a game laptop, which I'd argue oftentimes that's not worth it just for a little more FPS that you probably wouldn't notice if you were staring at the FPS counter in the corner. So I'm very happy with the way this thing games. From what I've seen, the 3060 is about like 10 to 20% behind depending on the game. So just something to keep in mind. All right, so my final thoughts. The Flow X16, in my opinion, is probably the best gaming laptop I've ever used. The quirks are not that noticeable, and they're very easy to get over when it has so much good going for it. I'd say this is probably the closest thing I've used to being the perfect gaming laptop. It has upgradable RAM and storage, unlike the Zephyrus models. It has an amazing keyboard and trackpad, some of the best speakers I've heard from a gaming laptop. It's one of the quietest gaming laptops I've used for the performance that it puts out. The CPU performs better than the Zephyrus models. You've got the integrated RDNA 2 graphics, great battery life. For some reason, that beats the G15s. Thunderbolt compatible USB 4 ports coming soon. Let's not forget one of the coolest parts, you know, the 16x10 mini LED touchscreen display with pen support that has insanely high color accuracy and gets way brighter than any display I've ever seen out there. And it's a glossy finish. It's easily the best display I've ever seen, and I'd bet a good amount of people would even prefer it over OLED. I mean, I have an OLED TV at home, and I can confidently say that this thing gets like 3 times brighter. But I am curious to try one of those new 240Hz OLED panels just to see what those are about. Oh, and also the fact that you get all of these things in a thin and light chassis that's a 2-in-1. Like, they literally packed this thing with every possible feature you could want. Want better thermals and lower fan speeds? Play it in tent mode. Want to scroll through Facebook on a giant tablet? Tablet mode. Want to use it like a regular laptop? Sure, you can do that too. Want to dock this thing to an Asus external GPU for even more graphics power? Go right ahead. So, it's hard for me to admit that I like a laptop better than the G15, but this thing is just, it's superior in every way. The only downside is the price. I'll admit, I can't be too mad at the price because this thing is just packed with features, and comparatively, there's really nothing out there like it. And honestly, it's priced competitively relative to like other laptops in its price range, at least here in the US. So for example, the Blade 15 here with the 3080 Ti is nearly $4,000. This is a much better purchase decision in every way to something like that. And considering how much more it has to offer than like the G15 or M16, it makes sense that it costs more than those. But overall though, like all 2022 laptops are just expensive at this moment, and I wish they would all go down in price a bit. But hey, I don't regret my decision to make this my daily driver. I know for a fact that the price is definitely going to drive a lot of people away, so just be aware of that going into it. It's expensive. The 3060 model is probably a better buy for most people that don't need all that GPU power. That one's already gone on sale at Best Buy for like $1,799, I think, which, I mean, that's like $1,000 less than the 3070 Ti one, so... But hey, I mean, there's really nothing else like this thing. So when you have such a unique product, it makes sense. I hate it, but it makes sense. So anyways, super happy with this laptop. Definitely worth checking out if you're looking into something with a 2-in-1 or touchscreen, or just you need something in a thin and light factor that's going to run a little quieter than most. Definitely worth checking out. Anyways, thanks so much, guys. Hope you liked this video. If you did like it, please subscribe, leave a comment, leave a like. All that stuff helps the channel grow, and we just passed 4,000 subscribers, so I'm super happy for that. Really appreciate everyone's support for this channel, and I love making these videos, so thank you so much, guys. See you next time.